Hi, this is Ask GMBN Tech, our weekly Q&A clinic show where hopefully we get to answer some of your mountain bike tech related questions. So fire your questions in the comments below this very video, or alternatively email us on the screen now is the email address. And don't forget to use the hashtag Ask GMBN Tech. So first up this week is from Peter Nikolov. I want to know, what's the difference between different rear suspension linkages for months now? I've asked once or twice, but nothing has happened. Okay, hi Peter. So firstly, we do get an awful lot of emails, so we can't actually get back to every single person. We do try to get through them, so sorry yours hasn't been answered yet. And secondly, well, there's a lot of different suspension designs out there. Too much, in fact, to go into detail in this particular show. I think it warrants a dedicated video on that. But that said, there are four main designs out there. And within those designs, there are a lot of different variations. And of course, there are some anomalies. But those main designs, I'll give you a quick rundown on those. So there's single pivot. There's single pivot with a linkage driven shock. There's a four bar. And then there's the short link system, which is also a short link four bar. So first up, let's take a look at a single pivot. So on screen now, you can see an orange. So this is your classic single pivot. So there's a pivot just above the chainring there, as you can see, and there's a nice long swing arm, and the rear axle moves in a rough sort of arc pattern, and the shock is simply attached at the top of the swing arm and to the down tube. So this is a very simple system, and it does rely a little bit more on the shock tune rather than leverage that's built into the frame design itself. When it's done right, it's a very clean and simple system that does work well, although depending on the positioning of that rear brake caliper, when using that brake, it can firm up the suspension. Now, the single pivot linkage driven design, so on screen now, is a common cell meta. So this looks very similar to the four bar design, and is often referred to as a faux bar because of this. So still, it's effectively a single pivot design because there's one bar basically between the main pivot and the rear wheel axle that moves. So the rear wheel axle still moves in that arc movement, except there's a link just above the seat stay there, sorry, just connecting the seat stay, and there's also in this particular design a swing link that drives the shock. So it's a linkage driven shock, and because of that, the designers can tune the leverage on that and the way that they want that back end to feel. So there's a lot more you can do with this design than you can with a regular single pivot. However, again, depending on position of that brake caliper, it can be susceptible to the rear suspension firming up slightly under braking. But the motion of that rear single pivot is a very effective one. It's really good for all-round bump absorption and probably one of the best out there. So next up is the classic four bar linkage design. Now this is one of the most tried and tested designs out there, and funnily enough is actually what a lot of modern downhill bikes are going back to again at the moment, because it's very effective and it can be tuned in a lot of different ways. Now on screen now is a nuke-proof mega. Now if you look along the main chainstay there, you see there is a pivot before the rear wheel axle. Now that is the defining part of what makes a bike a four bar system. And if you have a look at the rough layout of that rear end, it's fairly similar to the common cell, except for that pivot placement. On the common cell, again, it's on screen now, you'll see it's on the seat stay. Now back to the nuke proof and you'll see it's on the chainstay. Now the fundamental effect of having the pivot on the chainstay rather than on the seat stay is it changes the axle path. So the previous two designs, the axle moves in the same path, is the only difference is depending on where the main pivot is, and it would slightly tune the way the axle moves. Now this particular design, by having that pivot on the chainstay, dramatically changes the way that that rear axle path works. Now effects of that are how it pedals. It manages to pedal very well, but also how it's affected with braking. By having a brake on the separate part of the swing arm to where that pivot is, you're actually almost isolating it. It's as near as isolating as you can get without having a different system altogether. Now it's a very popular system. As I explained a minute ago, there's a lot of different variations that use this system and are very common today. And finally, there is the twin link sort of bikes out there. Now there are a lot of twin links, and technically they're kind of four bars because they still have a link between, basically separating that main swing arm. And there's two sort of main designs out there. Obviously there are a lot of them, but the obvious ones are the VPP and the DW link. Now the VPP, if you look on screen now, you'll see a Santa Cruz. Now those linkages move in different directions. So, and because of that, the way the suspension works, it actually has, the suspension design is combated by chain forces. So it's a sort of 50-50 thing where the chain forces actually stop the suspension from operating, yet the bump force will override that and allow the suspension to work. So it's obviously tuned in various different ways. On the downhill bikes, for example, it's less efficient to pedal, more efficient for bump absorption. On the cross-country bikes, it's the other way around, of course, to make them ultimately efficient for pedaling and maybe less so on the bump end. But the idea is that it's chain tension that combats the forces of the suspension. So it's a very unique system, works very well, and it's used by a lot of different companies. Now the other system, as you see on screen now, is a DW linkage. Now this one's an Ibis bike. Now these links move in the same direction, and one of the major characteristics of this system is it has anti-squat. And this is effectively, when you're pedaling, you get slight extension. So it doesn't squat into that suspension, robbing you of energy. It actually sits the bike up very slightly. Now this is very noticeable, or certainly more noticeable on days of multiple chainrings. If you're changing certain gears, you will definitely notice that effect. But with a single chainring now, you can barely notice this other than the positive side. It doesn't sag, basically, when you're pedaling hard. These bikes tend to climb very well and have a really sort of nimble, agile feel, whereas a lot of the VPP bikes tend to have a bit more of a planted feel. Now, again, they do look similar at a glance, but just to show you that they're very different bikes and they're handled in different ways. Now, we will go into more detail about these suspension designs because there are so many, but it does require a longer video, and I need to work out the simplified way of explaining all of them in an easy to understand way. So bear with me on that and I'll come back to you. Okay, next up is from Patrick Kremen. Would you call a 150mm front and rear bike an enduro bike or a trail bike? I think today you would probably find that a lot of manufacturers with that amount of travel on bikes would call them trail bikes or all mountain bikes, and anything with more travel would be called an enduro bike. But it's not just as simple as the amount of travel on the bike. It's really more about how the bike is constructed, how strong it is, the angles on that bike, and they kind of dictate what it's designed for more, I think, than just the amount of suspension travel on there. So for example, if you have a look at the Santa Cruz Bronson and the Santa Cruz Nomad, so the Bronson is their all mountain or their trail bike, and the Nomad is their enduro bike. Now there's about 15 mil difference in travel between the two bikes, the Bronson obviously having 150 mil, but lots of people race enduro on that Bronson frame. It's more than capable of it, it's just that's not its target aim. So you could say it's an enduro bike, or you could say it's an all-mountain bike, or perhaps even enduro light, whatever you want to call it. It's capable, it's not a problem. And just to reinforce that point, Yeti have a number of different bikes, both in 27.5 and 29-inch wheels that are ridden by their team enduro riders like Richie Voude. And at the first race this year, which was in Chile, he was actually riding an SB5.5. So that's a 29-inch wheel bike with just 140mm of travel. And if you look on the Yeti bike's website, they say trail stroke enduro. They're not categorizing their bikes too much, but of course, at the lighter end for the XC trail, I'm sure that they would say that. So it just goes again to show it's what the bike's capable of, not how much travel it has. Next is a brake-related question from Ambrose Good. Question, does it make any difference whether disc brake calipers are fitted on the bike for performance, as in the front of the fork or behind it? Also, I've noticed the rear can be in different locations. Okay, well, there is going to be a definite sort of mechanical advantage to the disc brake calipers being on the back of the fork and on the back of the frame, just because of the rotation that the wheel works in. So you're pushing the caliper into the frame, so it's not going to put as much stress on things like the bolts and the mounting system. However, there have been designs over the years that have had them in different places for various different reasons. Although at the moment, I think the biggest advantage on the rear end of bikes, you're starting to see the caliper inside that sort of rear sort of triangle, as it were, between the seat stay and the chain stay. That's a great position because the chain stay is often the stronger of the two. It's often thicker and stiffer. Also, it does give the caliper a bit of protection from being bashed against things. So just look at this example of a caliper that's hidden on the inside there and one that is not right now that's on the top. You think in a big crash, the one up on the top is a bit more exposed and prone to being damaged than that one that's hidden on the inside. Now, on the front fork, they are pretty much always on the back, probably for a safety aspect more than anything else. If you were to mount a caliper on the front, you're going to be pulling against those bolts. Of course, the bolts' tensile strength, I'm sure, would be fine with that, but the point is you're pulling off the fork rather than pulling into the fork or pushing into the fork. Now, I did once see a handmade bike, I think it was a bespoke bicycle show, and this guy had built a right-legged fork, a righty, as you were, and to get around the braking, he ended up using a traditional front brake caliper, which would be mounted on the left. He mounted it on the right-hand side, on the front of the leg. Now, straight away, alarm bells were ringing, although I'm sure it probably would be okay in normal use. However, on this particular bike, he had horizontal dropouts on there. So not only is the brake caliper on the front trying to pull itself off the actual fork, you've got those horizontal dropouts on there. And if that sort of quick release lever or the lever holding the wheel comes even the tiniest bit loose under braking, surely that front wheel is in risk of popping out, which just seems like madness to me. So I think you'll find, you know, there's mechanical advantage and also safety aspects as well. Next up is a pedal related question from Lorenz Scherer. Hi Doddy, I'm riding the Crank Brothers Stamp and 510 Freerider Pro, but my feet don't stick to pedals very well. Is it worth getting the 10mm pins because I'm riding the 8s, or should I get another pedal? Well, obviously getting pins is a lot cheaper than getting another pedal, so I'd certainly address that first before forking out for some new pedals. I use the stamps, I find them great, although I'm very picky with my setup. I use the larger of the two size stamps, and I do use those longer pins, but I use the shorter ones in the middle just to make it a bit more of a concave shape. And I know that Neil and Blake do the same thing on theirs, although I think both of them run the smaller size. Interesting you say about the shoes. So I've got a set of Freerider VXIs tucked away somewhere, and they don't feel particularly good on that pedal. They feel a little bit clumpy, and perhaps you can't, because you can't feel it as well, they're not gripping as well. Whereas other shoes I've got that have got a completely flat sole on them, like just a pair of Vans or various other shoes, have got stick like immensely on them. So it definitely pays to get them set up right and make sure your shoe combo with them is right. And there's no reason why your Freeriders, so they've got quite a flat sole, shouldn't work. I've also got a set of Freeriders, regular ones that I use, and they work great. So definitely try with the pins first, because it'll save you a fortune. And it's a good pedal at the end of the day, and you can obviously maintain the axle and stuff afterwards. So take care of those and get the pins. Next up is from Joe O'Carroll. Hi Doddy, just wondering, do you have any tips on what to do when leaving a bike outside all year round at uni? Well, I'm assuming that you lock the bike up for starters, so if that's the case, then obviously make sure you use some sort of water displacer or some spray lube on the locking mechanisms, because they can get sticky over time. But really the best thing you can do is get yourself a cover for that bike. It could be a cover that you can just chuck in a carrier bag when you go riding, and when you lock it back outside, put the cover over it, and it's going to help resist surface rust and stuff like that on your bolts and other parts of the bike. Obviously weather is not ideal to leave a bike out in. Most things will be fine, but you're going to get surface rust develop. If you can't do that, then using some sort of mild lubricant or water displacing stuff on tops of bolt heads and over your drivetrain is a good idea. But obviously when you spray that stuff on there, make sure it goes nowhere near your disc rotors. I'd always recommend having a bit of shop towel or rag or something just to cover them when you're spraying in that area. But generally you want to make sure that the water can't really sort of harm your bike in any way. And also I'd say get into regular habits of cleaning your drivetrain and your transmission and stuff on your bike, because you can monitor where you are getting patches of surface rust and that, and you can scrub that stuff off as long as it's not sort of bedded in too much. Generally just try and keep your bike dry as you can and make sure it's well lubricated. Okay, next is from Kenneth Marks. Hi Doddy, I'll soon be in the market for a mid-travel bike, and a friend mentioned the 2018 Cube Stereo 140 HPC TM to me. That's a bit of a mouthful, isn't it? Spec on this bike is unbelievable for the price. It's €3,499, but I'm a little concerned about the quality of the carbon fibre frame. I can't find too much on the durability, and I was wondering if you had any thoughts. Even if the frame breaks after a couple of years, I'll still get a great component list to throw on a better frame. That's my thinking. Cheers. Okay, well, Cube bikes for starters, don't be put off by them. They're a great brand, they've got great reputation, and they've got really good warranties. So I did look it up, and there's a few different warranty options for that particular bike, just so you know this. So because of your one, it's not like the Enduro model, you've got a 3-year warranty on that frame. So for starters, that's great against manufacturing defects and all the usual stuff. But they also offer a crash replacement policy, where if you do manage to damage your bike in a crash or another sort of situation, you can buy a new frame at a discounted rate. Now it's a lot of teasing sort of terms and conditions with that sort of thing, so you need to look into that. But That is good assurance from my point of view that there'd be a reputable brand to buy from. Of course, they are fantastic value, and like you pointed out, worst case scenario, if the frame was trashed after 2 or 3 years, you still got some really good stuff to move on to your next bike. But I wouldn't even be thinking about that. I think they're really good value bikes, and I don't think you'll have any issues with them. Got plenty of friends that ride them, and they really enjoy their Qeeo bikes, so I'd get involved if I was you. So there we go, there's another Ask GMBN Tech Clinic in the bag. If you've got any questions, fire them in, and fire them in on email. Keep them coming in, we love that stuff. For a couple more videos, click down here for our Nova Mesto XC Tech. That's all the great stuff we found at the latest round of the XC World Cup. And click down here for our Trailside Maintenance Mistakes. As always, click on that round globe to subscribe, share it around, tell everyone about us, and if you found this video useful, give us a thumbs up.